Hi, I'm very honored to receive this year's most influential Popple paper award for my Popple 2011 paper that describes the technology behind the flashless feature in Excel. I want to thank everyone who I have had the good fortune to work with over the years. No achievement happens in a vacuum, and my contributions are all reflective of the collective work and support of many fantastic people and teams in my professional and personal life. Thank you. This paper was the most important turning point in my research philosophy and career. It was when I switched from searching for the hardest problem I could solve to searching instead for the simplest problem that would have the most impact when solved. In this talk, I would like to share the journey that led to this change and talk about what happened next. This is a journey that is at least as much cultural as it is technical, and it holds both professional relevance and deep personal meaning for me. My first brush with program synthesis came when I was being considered for a job at Microsoft Research. I was presenting to a group of researchers about random interpretation, which was my PhD topic at UC Berkeley. I explained it as an instance of forward program analysis, wherein it involved flowing example states forward in a program. There was a machine learning researcher in the audience, Nibosh Jojik, and he asked me if it was possible to flow such example states backward. I said, yes, that would be an instance of backward program analysis. And then he asked, what if these states are known, but the program statement is unknown? That I thought would be program synthesis, and it's what I hoped I would work on if I went to Microsoft. Now, as I look back, I see that moment as the most profound insight in disguise for developing FlashFill, to flow examples backward through unknown program statements. I started my program synthesis career at Microsoft with an interest in synthesizing complicated algorithms with tricky non-intuitive components. For instance, how do you multiply two by two matrices using 7 multiplications instead of 8? That's a question I asked my instructor way back in 1995 when he mentioned this concept in an introductory programming course during my first year of college. His response was that this kind of premium material was only meant for CS students while I was enrolled in the EE program. Upset at this, I wrote the college entrance exam again and was finally admitted to CS. 15 years later, I had my dash of revenge when, together with Saurabh Srivastava and Jeff Foster, we developed a technique that could automatically synthesize such algorithms and several variants of it from logical specifications. Coincidentally, the paper that we wrote on this technique also received that 10-year Most Influential Paper Award just last year. A key idea in that paper was to use a template language to represent the space of possible expressions. Templates paved the way for DSLs, domain-specific languages, which have been the cornerstone for scalable and robust synthesis in various recent success stories, starting out with FlashFill. One thing that this paper made us realize was that logical specifications are too complicated to author. And then we wondered, what if the user expresses intent using input-output examples, since this is what we were really using to debug both logical specifications and programs? However, the examples are extremely ambiguous form of intent specification. And that's where this ICSI paper that I co-authored with Ashish Tiwari, Sushmit Jha, and Sanjeev Sesia shows that the user can be guided to provide the right set of examples to converge to the intended algorithm. This ICSI paper coincidentally also received the 10-year Most Influential Paper Award a few months ago and addressed the challenge of synthesizing tricky bit vector algorithms. In spite of all of this, my manager wasn't impressed. And he asked me, have you been able to synthesize any new algorithm? In fact, that was the most common question I was asked. I quickly realized I would never be able to make the machine compete with Donald Knuth. So instead, I had to find customers who would be grateful for the programs that a machine can synthesize for them from examples. It was with all that on my mind that I happened to have a chance encounter on an airplane, one that would completely change my life. I was flying from Frankfurt to Seattle, returning home from a workshop on program synthesis. Sitting in the seat besides me was a nice lady, and we had the kind of nice conversation you have on a long flight. She was impressed to know that I had a PhD in computer science and that I worked for Microsoft Research. And she then asked me if I could help her with a problem that she was struggling with. She opened up her laptop, fired up Excel, showed me a column of names which were listed in the format first name space last name. And she asked me, how can I reformat this column so that it lists the last name first instead of first name? Unfortunately, I had no clue at all. I was totally unfamiliar with the programming model underneath Excel. So I had to sheepishly excuse myself out of the situation. After returning home, I searched for a solution to her problem on Excel help forums. And it is then that I realized that there were many, many people who struggled with simple repetitive tasks like that of the airplane lady. They would solicit the help of an expert on a help forum while communicating their intent using a few input-output examples. But such interactions would often spend several days and would require multiple rounds of interaction. So this inspired me to develop a technology that can essentially automate the role of the expert on the help forum, thereby enabling users to automate their simple repetitive tasks in a few seconds instead of having to wait for several days. It took me 3 weeks to develop a first prototype of FlashFill. But before then, I had spent 3 months studying spreadsheet help forums to narrow down the exact scope for the problem definition and identify the right set of benchmarks. Many people in academia told me that I got lucky with FlashFill because I worked for Microsoft and they assumed that the Excel team had supplied the problem definition and the set of benchmarks. I was like, excuse me, only if you would be crazy enough to spend 3 months studying help forums instead of authoring your next research paper. Even the Excel team agreed that my benchmarks were the right ones and that we should use those to evaluate the quality of our solution. This exercise led me to my first learning, that of customer connection. I was looking for the simplest problem that most people cared about, and in this case, I identified that to be syntactic string manipulations. The intensive study of Excel help forums further helped me design an appropriate domain-specific language for FlashFill to program in. This language is expressive enough to cater to many key scenarios, while restricted enough to allow for design of an effective program synthesis algorithm on top of it. The reason why this paper stands out amongst my 100 plus papers is the wide customer reach that FlashFill has had by shipping with Excel. So what did it take to ship such a technology? Desire and commitment to build robust implementations of cutting-edge research work, which in turn leads to a virtuous cycle of innovation. The Excel team said they couldn't ship FlashFill unless it was able to synthesize intended programs from just one example in most common cases, because otherwise users would lose trust in the feature and make fun of it. And many users wouldn't even know that they could provide two or more examples. We answered that challenge by developing appropriate program ranking techniques, rephrasing the synthesis problem as that of synthesizing a program that not only satisfies the examples, but is also ranked the highest. The Excel team further insisted that FlashFill be super efficient. It should take a fraction of a second to search for an intended program in the underlying domain-specific language. This ruled out use of enumerative search techniques that would exhaustively explore the state space, say in a bottom-up enumeration style, starting with programs of increasing size. These techniques do not scale, since the programs that we care about are relatively big. The efficiency requirement also ruled out use of any constraint solver-based modeling because of their unpredictability. So this inspired me to develop a top-down directive synthesis technique that is goal-directed and is based upon backward flow of example states or backpropagation across program statements, similar to weakest precondition computation. So now you can see how the Excel product string constraints around the user experience drove the FlashFill innovation. And this brings me to my second learning, which is that everything works better when research and engineering skills and mindset comes together as part of one team committed to a single mission. You see, research is about embracing uncertainty, while engineering is about removing uncertainty. These somewhat opposing values, when put together, actually leads to faster innovation. I now manage a blended research and engineering team where I try to nurture an inclusive environment for leveraging both research and engineering skills and mindset. While someone else may get inspired by one of your ideas, build on it, and drive it to impact, a perspective that you may also consider is, if you don't believe in your idea, then why should someone else? Flashfill turned out to be a very popular feature in Excel, with around a million invocations each week. Flashfill can automate a wide variety of string transformations, anything that is expressible using the underlying domain-specific language. However, there are many tasks that it cannot do, such as number or date transformations. But the user experience is so inviting that people invariably want to give it a try, even on tasks that it was never meant for, and then talk about it when it does not work. There was this tweet on October 2018 that made fun of Flashfill and was reshared more than 10,000 times. Twitter user Darren wrote, "AI is going to take over the world. Look what Excel auto-populated for me today." Darren gave an example converting DEC to December, and Flashfill auto-completed JAN to Janember and OCT to October. Some people came to our defense, arguing that this is how we should have named months in the first place. I recently came across a shipping label where someone even decided to incorporate Flashfill as part of their process automation. My team found it funny enough to print this tweet on a t-shirt. And now this t-shirt is often my dress shirt for my keynotes. You know, the best thing about this kind of customer feedback is that it lets you know what task domains to prioritize, since there is pretty much no limit to how intelligent the synthesizer can be for such map transformations. Now consider, what would it take to handle such transformations? The first thing that we would need to do is to expand the underlying domain-specific language to allow expression of programs for manipulating such data types, like dates and numbers. Then we would need to extend and refine the search algorithm. But once we do that, we immediately run into two challenges. First, the search algorithm becomes slower, and second, the ranking becomes less effective. And now we have to fine-tune both search and ranking heuristics. This game gets harder with every extension. So this inspired us to use machine learning techniques to learn heuristics for speeding up search and to improve effectiveness of ranking. Interestingly enough, this is also reminiscent of some feedback from a reviewer on the Flashfill paper who saw far ahead and cautioned the use of manual heuristics. For speeding up search, we now use machine-learned heuristics to order the search goals generated by the top-down backpropagation-based deductive search. For instance, which grammar protection or which sub-goal resulting from inverse semantics to try out first. We have obtained an order of magnitude improvement in the speedup of the underlying algorithm on certain task instances in our benchmark suite. For effective ranking, we use machine learning-based ranking functions to prefer programs based on their structure. There are a variety of features that can be leveraged, such as use of a certain operator or a specific code pattern, number of constants, or even size of those constants. Another useful idea has been to look at the outputs generated by a synthesized program on the various other available inputs. The uniformity of outputs produced by a program can be used as additional feature to rank programs. So this brings me to my next learning, that of cross-disciplinary research. It is extremely rewarding, but hard. You can notice the cultural tension around cross-disciplinary work in this other review portion. I also had a natural tendency to continue exploration in my own narrow area of expertise, which was logical reasoning. It required a different kind of thinking and a big leap to start appreciating the importance of other research areas like machine learning, and to figure out ways in which I can partner with other experts and get results that I would not have been able to produce by myself. Today, the researchers in my blended research and engineering team have expertise in diverse research areas. I believe a cross-disciplinary team has much higher chance of producing disruption. So this is where the Indian adage, 1 plus 1 equals 11, comes true, which refers to the sum being more than its parts. Let me further illustrate these three learnings by sharing two research works that were inspired by flash film. PBE or programming by examples can be applied to several other task domains besides string transformations. Basically, anywhere where it is easy to express intent using examples but tedious to author the programs. One such domain is that of extracting tabular data from semi-structured documents like custom text files, web pages, or PDF. For instance, consider the task of extracting tabular data from this web page for doing some analysis. Authoring a parser or using CSS selectors would be tedious and time-consuming. Instead, the user can simply describe their intent by giving one or two examples of the various fields that they want to extract. And a PBE technology can synthesize an intended parser from that specification. We've actually shipped such PBE technologies as data connectors for Power Query that allow users to extract tabular data from semi-structured documents such as PDF, web pages, or even custom text files. These features have been voted as amongst the top features in Power Query. Recently, we were very heartened to see that these connectors were used by people to build dashboards for various COVID-19 datasets. Let me now share how the various learnings that I talked about inspired the technology behind this feature. To study customer needs, we studied customer voice forums to identify feature requests with highest number of votes. We also participated in so-called Moneyball activity inside Microsoft, a six-week exercise where we do nothing but just connect with customers. We source them from our social contacts, send them an email, do phone interviews, and then bring them over to Microsoft for a workshop in the first 3 weeks. And then we repeat the process again after we apply our learnings. This sensitized us to the needs of data scientists and data engineers who apparently spend 80% of their time wrangling data, bringing it into a form that they can then apply ML techniques to. We then approached the Power Query product team with a proposal to enable tabular data ingestion from examples. They said, "Sumit, we don't have time to build a UI for the user to provide examples. Can you make it work with zero examples?" I initially thought that they were crazy, but then I realized it made sense. If there are tens of fields in a document, then giving 1 to 2 examples for each field would actually be tedious, even though it is way better than having to author a parser yourself. We then built a solution that synthesizes intended programs from just the input. We call it predictive synthesis. You can liken it to the unsupervised learning in the machine learning world. Mohammad Raza, Daniel Perelman, and Wu Lei on my Prost team have been leading development of this technology using cross-disciplinary inspiration. The key idea is to infer repetitive structures over the input while simultaneously learning programs in a bottom-up enumeration style that compute that structure. We then combine this with the standard top-down PBE methodology to ship a hybrid user experience for web page table extraction that can learn from very few examples if the predictive mode fails. For PDF table extraction, we even leveraged computer vision techniques to improve accuracy. PBE can be applied to not just data transformations, but also code transformations. For instance, consider the task of making the red-green edits in this code base, where the goal is to lift the model variable from being part of an argument list to an invocation expression. These edits are repetitive in the sense that they can be programmed by authoring an edit script that operates over the AST of this code base. However, it would be quite tedious and tricky to author those scripts, especially for a one-off task. Instead, PBE technologies can be used to learn such edit scripts from a few examples. In fact, we recently shipped such a PBE technology as the IntelliCode Suggestions feature in Visual Studio. the fastest that I have experienced in my career, thanks to research and product that co-evolved. There is increasing adoption of this technology with several tens of thousands of monthly engaged users and accepted suggestions per day. We have seen tons of happy tweets, and we even found pleasantly surprising mentions at places where we never expected. Commits in GitHub and repositories that users created to demonstrate how good the feature is. Let me now share how the various learnings that I talked about inspired the technology behind this feature. We started out by analyzing GitHub commits and code evolution patterns within editors to understand the market opportunity for so-called repetitive edits. Then when we first approached the Visual Studio product team with a proposal to automate such repetitive edits using examples, they mentioned that it won't be usable in its standard PBE form, because not many developers would even know that this feature exists. Furthermore, if they had to do a few edits, then going into a mode and giving two examples would be too much of an overhead to be useful. And also, it won't fit the natural workflow of a user, where they might do an edit or two and only then realize that there are other related edits to be performed as well. This motivated us to study a new problem definition of inferring the user's intent from a few example edits that are not provided explicitly, but implicitly. The edits that are hidden in their natural and noisy workflows. The developer goes about doing their task naturally without getting into any mode, while the underlying engine watches, learns, and then makes suggestions. We call this modeless synthesis, since the user is not required to get into any mode to provide examples. The technical problem that it yields is that of guessing what the examples of any repetitive pattern even are in the underlying trace of keystrokes. Arjun Radhakrishna and Gustavo Source on my pros team have been leading development of this technology using cross-disciplinary inspiration. First, we developed a domain-specific language for code edits and an example-based synthesis algorithm for it. Then we developed a technology on top of it to infer related examples within noisy traces to create a first prototype. To further improve false positives and negatives, we used inspiration from HCI and ML and have developed techniques that leverage other signals like cursor location and partial user edits. While there is now increasing adoption of this technology, we have come across some negative tweets asking how these suggestions can actually be turned off. Now, this is actually a blessing in disguise, as it points to improvement opportunities around false positives and feeds back into our research. A perfect example of co-evolution of paper and product. This brings me to my last learning, which reveals how do we scale development of such sophisticated AI capabilities for so many task domains with limited resourcing. Instead of creating one implementation and then another from scratch for each new domain, we decided to do something bigger and better. Create an algorithmic framework with reusable components that provides value to all domains. This was hard work. We made multiple attempts, many of which failed, but some of which took us slowly and steadily to the reusable insights behind our synthesizers. This framework has since served as the foundation for designing and developing new domain-specific synthesis algorithms and implementations, yielding an order of magnitude improvement in our effectiveness to provide solutions for different verticals. Interestingly enough, this is what one of the reviewers demanded at the time of the paper itself, but it took us 3 more years. Thanks to Alex Polozo for leading this work. The beautiful thing that I later realized about this technical framework is that it also facilitates teamwork. It enables researchers to build on the work of others by leveraging framework components when they create specific solutions, and to contribute to others' success by generalizing their solutions and contributing generic components to the framework. We have leveraged this framework to develop extensions to FlashFill that can handle date and number transformations of the kind that you saw in the scenario where FlashFill failed, and much more. For instance, consider the task of extracting the red date from the string in the input column and mapping it to the corresponding weekday. The user also wants to extract the green time and bucketize it into a 3-hour bucket. Just imagine how much code you would have to write to accomplish this task. Now, this can be done using just one example. The new Flashville++ API can now facilitate sophisticated map transformations and is available as part of the PROS SDK. So these are the four cultural learnings that Flashville led me to. The common elixir behind each of these uplifting transitions and values is that of connection, not just between ideas, but with people. An empathic connection with our customers, our research colleagues from our area and other areas, and with the corporate world to deliver the right innovation. We can also put these three connections as part of the golden circle paradigm that Simon Sinek has talked about. First comes why. Why do we do what we do? This is where we start with our customers. Then comes how. This is where we stand on the shoulders of our giant colleagues and partner with them on cross-disciplinary research for disruptive innovation. And finally, the what, that speaks to working with our industrial partners to deliver customer value and in fact leverage their feedback to even close the loop. Interestingly, this isn't different from the structure of the research papers we write, where first comes motivation, then the technique, and finally its implementation. I hope this framing can help some of you make conscious choices about the why, how, and what of your work. A couple of years ago, when I created my profile on Medium and Twitter, I had 160 characters to describe myself. My old self, when looking at my current CV, not unlike many of yours, may have said something like this. I think my biggest transformation has been to ponder what is most meaningful for me, and that inspired me to pick this summary instead, that is structured around the connections that I identify myself with. Since there was a little bit more space, I also sneaked in this. On the technical side, even after a decade of Flashville, we are just getting started in the area of program synthesis. The potential for program synthesis is huge. It can enable most people on the planet to achieve more. 99% of all computer users do not know programming. Even programmers spend most of their time writing plumbing code or doing maintenance tasks that can be automated. We have intriguing possibilities for developing new classes of techniques that combine logical reasoning, which is best at modeling program semantics, and machine learning, which is best at modeling the bias in real world and user's intent. The user experiences are also very critical in deployment of program synthesis techniques. Flashville popularized the use of examples to express intent. However, there are several tasks where natural language is the best way to express intent. And for some tasks, you need a combination. It is also important to leverage the overall context and the workflow of the user. If you look at the history, we went from punched cards in assembly language to high-level languages and beautiful code editors. The next evolution, I think, will take programming closer to human conversation, involving use of multimodality and interactivity. While I hope to continue to play my part in it, most interestingly, I look forward to learning from and cheering the advances that the next generation of researchers will bring. To conclude, I would like to thank the program committee members for their acceptance of a work that defied the fashion of the times with its practical emphasis and cross-disciplinary components. Coincidentally, I was part of the PC, and initially POPL 2011 had a rule stating that no single authored PC submissions would be entertained. I asked the PC chair Muli Sagib if I should add my wife's name to the paper, and he was kind enough to immediately retract this requirement. I would also like to thank the award committee members for the recognition of this work. This paper has been the most satisfying paper amongst the 100 plus papers that I have co-authored. You know, my dad, who retired as a civil engineer, has cheered every research paper I wrote and had accepted. But it was after this Flashville paper that he said, "For the first time, I understand what your research is about." My child Sumay, who was born the same year as Flashville shipped and is now 7 years old, has often asked me what kind of scientist I am and what inventions have I created. A surreal moment happened a few months ago when I was able to explain him just that. His class is now using many digital applications, each with unique usernames and passwords for every student. These credentials are communicated by his class teacher by sharing an example of the rule that drives them from the student's name and ID. This was my perfect opportunity to show Sumer how Flashful is smart enough to infer these credentials for any given name. And that connection with my child, that's bliss. As much as comes with the recognition from the academic community. Thank you.